Hey guys, welcome to Magic TV. My name's Craig. It is 12 o'clock on a Sunday, which means it's time for a Q&A. And after last week's Q&A, where I basically spent the entire video talking about my tattoos, we're going to be back to the normal format with this video. So I've got a whole bunch of questions that I have looked at that people have asked over the last week, and I'm going to try and answer them all straight away. So without further ado, let's get into the first question. So the first question is from Ablo Fluido. I know that you've asked questions on this channel before, so thank you very much, buddy. And your question is, what are some of your favourite books on card magic, especially ones that might be less well known? Well, as you know, I love books. And you know what? I was thinking about doing a video coming up on the channel in a few weeks' time of some of my favourite books that I actually really enjoy reading and I've learnt a lot of magic from. I'm a massive fan of One Degree. I'm a massive fan of One Degree by John Gustafaro. In fact, on Tuesday, we've got an interview with John G. So I'm doing a full interview with him and we actually discuss his One Degree theory. Now, why I love that book so much is because A, there's some really strong magic in it, but B, as well as having some really strong magic, what I really like about it is the concept or the theory of having a One Degree change to improve your magic. So if you've not seen One Degree, check it out. I also really like The Session by Joel Givens. It's a really older book now. It was one of the first books that Vanishing Ink brought out. But it's really great. It's kind of, it's written in sort of a pretend session type thing. It's really, really good. There's some really strong magic in there. Also, older books that you might not know about. I mean, is it 52 Thoughts? Again, another Vanishing Ink product by Jack Parker. Some super strong magic in there. And you know what? The three volume set of Sankey's material is just ridiculous. Some of the best card magic you'll ever see, as well as a whole bunch of other magic. And a lot of people overlook it because it's Sankey, but those three volumes are absolutely brilliant. 21st Century Card Magic by, is it James Swain? I think it is James Swain. That's a really good book as well. And you know, one of my favorite card books, which I'm thinking about reviewing on the show at some point, is Bloomberg Laboratories by Thomas Bloomberg. That is a great book as well. I mean, we can go further back and we can look at a whole bunch of other books, Derek Dingle, The Complete Works of Derek Dingle. You'll see some great stuff there. Pretty much anything by Darwin Ortiz is fantastic. But, those are a few good books to start with. But let me know in the comments down below, what's your favorite book? I've read it. Let me know. What's your favorite book? What's your favorite card magic book? Let me know down below. Okay, so the next question is by Paul Smith. Do you have any effects that you do specifically at Halloween? And the short answer, Paul, is no. No, I don't. It's the same reason why I don't really have any specific tricks that I do at Christmas or Easter or any other seasonal time of the year. To be honest, I don't like the idea of having a trick that I just do for like a week or 2 weeks. Because if I like a trick enough to do, to perform, I want to do it all the time. I don't want to be in a situation where I'm only doing it like for 1 week a year. And if I don't like it that much and I'm just putting it in because it fits a theme, well, it shouldn't be my act in the first place. There are certain tricks in my act that I do that fit better at Halloween. Because what I'll try to do is if somebody books me for a Halloween event, I'll say to them, I'll theme the magic that I do. I'll tell them that I'll theme the magic. So I won't necessarily do specific Halloween tricks, but I'll select tricks out of my repertoire that could have a Halloween slant to it. Close-up stuff that work really well in a sort of a Halloween type environment. Voodoo 2.0 by Nate Kranzo is an amazing trick. You can really play up the kind of the voodoo element on that. Single Needle by Wayne Houchin, again, is one that works really well, but that's really more for a stage performance. I do Eye Popper by Scott Alexander, which is where you take a spoon and you scoop your eye out and you show the eye on your spoon and then you just throw it back into your eye. I mean, that's a really visual thing that I throw into my act, especially at Halloween quite a lot. But, you know, the other stuff that you can do, if you do sponge balls, you can use sponge eyeballs instead of sponge balls, you know, stuff like that. But I tend to find that I'll just take stuff that I do in my normal shows, but I'll just select the material that has the best chance to easily be themed to a Halloween theme, if that kind of makes sense. So if I'm doing my illusion show, I'm going to be doing Needles by Scott Alexander. I'm going to be doing sort of Head Chopper and stuff like that. Okay, hope that makes sense. But yeah, generally as a rule, I tend not to buy a trick just to do specifically at one time of the year. So the next question is by Sean McNulty. Hey, Sean, thanks for asking another question. And he asks a question about the routine that I shared with you guys, my kind of coin and glass routine that I shared after reviewing CTG by Peter Egink. And he says, could you use a chop cup as part of the coin and glass routine? For example, do the chop cup, then move on to a coin and glass routine. You can. The only problem with that is... I like having a glass for that routine because they see the coin drop into the glass and also they hear it normally with a chop cup, or not necessarily always because they can be metal, but a lot of the time with a chop cup, they might have felt inside and you won't hear the coin landing, but they're always opaque. I mean, that's what a chop cup has to be. It has to be opaque. And so you would hear it, but you wouldn't see it. You wouldn't get that visual of the coin landing inside the cup. But with a glass, you have got that visual. They see the coin drop down and land inside the cup. So that would be my problem. I like the idea of routining from one routine with a cup into another routine with a cup, but I don't know about routining those two routines together because I think you'd be missing something if you followed up chop cup with that routine. But one thing that you could do is you could do chop cup, for example, and then you could say, now the problem with this, guys, is you can't see inside the cup. You know, it's opaque. So let's put this cup away and instead we'll use this glass. And the problem with this ball is when I drop it inside the cup, you can't hear it land. So I tell you what, instead of a ball, we'll use a coin. And now we'll do a routine with a cup. Now we'll do the same trick, but we'll use a coin and we'll use a glass. Now you can see the moment it happens and you can hear the moment it happens. So now you're justifying changing the props. You're routining from one routine to the other, that you've given a logical justification as to why you're actually switching from a cup to a glass and a logical justification as to why you're switching from a ball to a coin. And not just a logical justification, but you're actually making the effect more impossible from the audience's point of view, and that's really important. You have to have it so that the routine builds. So that's what I do. That's what I do, to be honest. But yeah, really great idea. Really great idea. Combine two routines that use a similar prop and makes a longer act out of it. So other than just trick, you're developing an act. Really good. So the next question is by Mr. Harmon. Hey, Mr. Harmon, how you doing? And he asks a question, if you are a mentalist, should you still do magic tricks? And the answer is, it depends on the type of mentalist that you are. You know, I've watched Richard Osterlind for years. I'm a massive Richard Osterlind fan. He's one of the top mentalists in the world. And, you know, I've seen him do magic tricks as part of his act. And he's not the only one. You know, John Archer, who is a comedy mentalist, I've seen him do magic tricks in his act. It very much depends. It really, really does. Like, if you are going down the Derren Brown route of a psychological illusionist and, you know, you're kind of like, hey, I'm going to influence you and influence you and blah, 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 and stuff like that, it'd be kind of weird to suddenly start producing sponge bunnies, you know what I mean? I don't think I'll ever see somebody like Derren Brown produce sponge balls or anything like that. But then you look at somebody like Max Maven, and let's look at Pocket Nightmare that we reviewed on the show a few weeks ago. Let's look at Pocket Nightmare, because Pocket Nightmare, if you actually think about it, it's a magic trick. Because the whole idea is that the card disappears from the deck and appears in his pocket, in his hand. That is a magic trick. You can't sell that as mentalism at all. And yet he's made a name for himself as a mentalist. So I think it really just comes down to knowing your character and understanding what you want your audience to believe. Now, there's some people that go full on hardcore mentalism. I mean, they are full on hardcore, I really have unworldly, ungodly powers. And if that's the case, a lot of magic tricks wouldn't really work, would they, really? But if you're kind of going down the route of almost like a mentalist, but you're kind of just saying, I'm not really doing this for real, I'm, you know, influencing or whatever it might be, then you know, there's no reason to not do some magic tricks. I think it's knowing your character, knowing what you want your audience to get from the performance, and understanding you're the only one that can really answer this, and you have to understand what you want the trick to achieve. The other thing is different routines can be played in different ways. And what I mean by that is I could do something like liquid metal and I could present it as a magic trick. So I could have, look, watch this fork, it's bending. I can do it as a magic trick. Look over here and you see the thing will bend over there. Or I can present it as a feat of mentalism. Look, hold on to the fork, it's going to bend in your hand. So again, the prop is just the prop. It's how you choose to present it. And a lot of magic props that are designed for magic tricks can be adapted to work for a mentalist. My advice on this is, in a couple of weeks' time, we've got an interview with Steve Deller. Now, if you don't know, Steve Deller is one of the top mentalists in the whole of the UK, but he's been performing for many, many years as a magician and a mentalist. And he talks about this in his interview, and it's an amazing interview to watch. So look out for it. It's coming up in a couple of weeks on the Talk Magic slot on Tuesdays. Have a look at that, because I think that will maybe answer a lot of the questions that you've got. Okay, so another question now by Mr. Harmon, and he asks, what routines do you think work for kids and adults? And was Ryland in that video, the Drayton Manor video at the front? Mr. Harmon's talking about the video I put up, and it was all about how to perform for children. And I put up a live performance of me doing a trick for kids, and it was Ryland. Ryland was there, and if you look next to Ryland, you'd see Thea, his sister. And they came to the show, and they were sitting. I love it when Ryland is in one of my shows, because he is the absolute perfect spectator. So yes, it was him at the front of the show that day. It's great when you've got a kid that's also a magician. It really, really, really helps. So yes, he was there. Now, what tricks work for kids and adults? Well, to be honest, as long as the trick is appropriate for kids, then most tricks... Here's the mistake that a lot of kids magicians make. A lot of kids magicians, what they'll do is they'll buy a trick that will work for kids but won't work for adults. Like, hey, boys and girls, look, this is little Freddy the Flea. And little Freddy the Flea is going to jump from this finger to this finger. And then little Freddy the Flea is going to jump back from this finger to this finger. Oh, look at that, boys and girls, it's Freddy the Flea. No, stop, right? Okay, just stop. Because here's the thing. The person that's booking you, right, is not the kid. The person that's booking you is the adult that's watching from the back of the room. And I always have the attitude of when I'm performing to children, I want to try and get it so that the adults that are at the back of the room are watching it and is enjoying it as much as the kids are. So yeah, you know, I'll do routines that are designed for kids. I do a colouring routine that absolutely kills, but I do it in a way that it engages the adults as well. And I think when you're talking about families, you need to look at that and you need to get out of that whole mindset. I remember the best piece of advice I was ever given when I started was by a guy called Lee Thompson, who is an amazing pickpocket, but he's also an amazing magician. And he went and saw me perform many, many years now at a place called Cadbury World, where I was doing a series of shows. And I had a big, massive audience in front of me, and he came up to me afterwards and he was like, that's really good, but you were just looking at the kids in the front row. And I was like, yeah, because I was there to book for the kids. I was booked to perform for the kids. And he's like, yeah, but look at the audience. There's like 100 adults there, and the adults were bored because you were just looking at the kids. Really make it. And he said to me, look over the kids, look at the adults, get them engaged as well. Make it a family show, not just a kid show. And Mr. Harmon, I suggest you look at John Kimmo. John Kimmo is one of the best family entertainers you'll ever see. Have a look at some of his videos on YouTube and you'll see what I mean. That's what I think anyway. But anyway, in terms of what routines work best, my three favorite routines to perform for a family audience that will work for kids and adults are Timmy Toilet Paper. Look it up. It's absolutely amazing by Tom Bergone, I think it is. What else? Linking Rings, specifically the Pop Hayden linking rings. So the Pop Hayden linking rings is absolutely amazing. I love that one. And if you want a classic kids prop, dots next, because I can have that work for kids and adults and everybody. And if you want to see an amazing performance of Dots Next, go on to Practical Magic's website. It's a magic dealer specifically for kids entertainers in the UK. Go on to Practical Magic's website, type in Dots Next, and look at the performance by Gary Dunn. He's the guy that owns Practical Magic. It is absolutely brilliant. You will watch that and you'll want to buy it immediately. So there you go. I hope that answers your question. Right, another question by Mr. Harmon. What is the best non-folded card to impossible location? What is the best non-folded card to impossible location? You know what, man? I got to be honest with you. It's got to be card to wallet. As simple as it sounds, but, you know, having a card disappear, going into a sealed envelope in a wallet, especially if you've given the wallet out and you go, here, look, hold on to this wallet for me. Open up the wallet. Inside the wallet, is that a sealed envelope? Is the envelope sealed? It is. Open up the sealed envelope. Wow. That for me is just killer. And I've looked for many, many years for something to replace that. And from a practicality and an impact point of view, I've never found anything. I also think you want to look at the mystery card plot. You want to look at the mystery card plot because that technically is a card to impossible location. The whole concept of I'm going to put a card down on the table and pick a card, sign a card, and the card that's been over there the whole time, that's your card. Now, my favorite version of card to impossible location from a mystery card point of view is by Simon Aronson. It's a Simon Aronson routine and it's called The World's Greatest Card Trick, I think it is. I think it's called The World's Greatest Card Trick. And it's, I put it on this channel. I'll put a link to it. I think it's called The World's Greatest Card Trick. It's absolutely amazing. You bring these instructions out and you say, look, I've got the instructions here for The World's Greatest Card Trick. I'm not getting a look at this because the secret's on this side. And what you do is you say, I'm going to read out these instructions, and they see instructions printed on it, and you're reading the instructions, and the instructions tell you to have a card picked and signed and lost in the deck, and it's all very, very clean. And at the end, you can't find the card. And then you say, well, the thing is, the secret's on the other side of the instructions. And the instructions that they examine that you've been holding the whole time, you turn it over and it's their signed card. Killer. Absolutely killer. Cards wallet. And outside of that, look into some mystery card plots. Right, next question is by Sean McNulty again. And the question is, do you have a structure when practicing new moves, tricks, or routines? I don't really have a structure, to be honest. When I get a new book, I'll look through it. And what I'll do is I'll read I'll read the foreword and introduction and everything like that. And then I'll look through the tricks and I'll look at the synopsis of the tricks. I'll look at what the effect is meant to be. And what I'll do is I'll make a note of any routines that I like the look of. And it doesn't mean I won't look at the other ones, but, you know, I have to prioritize in terms of which ones I learn first. So I'll go through and I'll look at those and I'll go, yeah, that sounds good. That sounds good. That sounds good. Oh, that would link with this. Let's have a look at this. And then what I'll do is I'll learn those routines first and then I'll go back and I'll look at the other ones and see if they tickle my fancy. If I see a routine that I particularly like, what I do is, first of all, I'll have the book open at a table. Don't get distracted. If you're learning a new routine, don't do it sitting in the front room with dogs and cats and kids and nuclear explosions going off all over the place. You want to just find a quiet room. I normally sit in my office. I'll have the book open with me. I'll have a pack of cards or whatever it is. And I'll just go through it step by step. And I'll go, hang on a second, that makes no sense. And I'll try and understand the routine, first of all. And that's the most important thing, trying to understand the routine. Once you've understood the routine, it's then a case of, you know, doing it over and over again. It's as simple as that. You got to keep doing it over and over again until you got to a point that it feels comfortable in your hands. And only then can you start working on the scripting. Only then can you kind of work on the presentation. And I'll always try to find a hook for the trick. And I'll try and find a hook very early on. In fact, my decision as to whether I'm going to learn that trick or not is based in many times on if I can think of a good hook for that trick. And then, you know, I've discussed this before on the Q&A, but briefly to go over it again, I'll video the whole thing. And I'll watch it back and I'll look at it and I'll go, okay, that sucked. Let me try that again. And the great thing these days is we can video things so easily on our phones. It allows me to look at material that I'm practicing and find out where the flaws are, the problems are, that you wouldn't know by just looking in a mirror or just practicing it to yourself. So that's it really. That's it. And have dedicated practice time. Don't just kind of, if you just think, oh, I'll just practice when I get time, you'll never get time. Have dedicated time that you can actually put aside to learning new tricks and new moves. The next question is by Paul Smith, and he says, I loved your performance of Twilight by Paul Harris. Thank you very much. Do you have any other favourites by Mr. Harris? I have a whole stack load of favourites by Paul Harris. Paul Harris is one of my favourite magicians. I'm not going to spoil it too much here, purely because I'm planning on doing a video soon where I actually highlight some of my favourite Paul Harris routines. I think that'd be really cool. But one of my favourite tricks that Paul Harris has ever released, and it's one that nobody ever does, is Strange Exchange. I absolutely love Strange Exchange. And if you haven't seen it, it's a coin and a card. You have the card signed, you can have the coin signed, whatever. It's a coin and a card, and boom, the coin and the card change places. No extras, no gimmicks. It looks like real magic. It's absolutely amazing. Strange Exchange by Paul Harris. I absolutely love that. It's probably my favorite Paul Harris routine. There are a lot of others, and I am, as I say, I am going to be going through all of these. But in terms of my favorite Paul Harris trick, that would have to be Strange Exchange. Oh, and by the way, I forgot to mention Solid Deck. Solid Deck was a big influence on me. I remember first watching Solid Deck and reading Solid Deck and thinking, oh my gosh, this is amazing. This is brilliant, and desperately wanting to learn it. And I remember learning it for the first time and just, it killed. It absolutely killed. Solid Deck is also very, very good. Okay, so the next question is again by Mr. Harmon. Is the Ultimate Remaxed Isolation by Kieran Johnson any good? Okay, great question. You know what? I know Kieran is great. You know, he's a great entertainer, great magician, great performer. And is it any good? I know people who kill with it. I've got a friend called Jester Styles, Tom Mullinger, and he kills with that trick. Kills with it. Because if you actually think about the effect on a layman or a spectator, you're making a block of ice appear, or you're making a card appear in a block of ice. That's mad. However, I have never performed it, and I will never perform it. And that's just a personal preference. And the reason is, when I go to a gig, and this isn't me being lazy, this is just the way I am. When I go to a gig, a close-up gig, I don't want to be sitting there for hours beforehand, before I even leave to go to the gig, making up gimmicks specifically for that gig. I don't want to be there shoving cards in oranges, shoving cards in Kit Kat bars, making blocks of ice. And then what I don't want to do is travel to the gig with a mini fridge. I don't want to be rocking up to a gig going, hi, my name's Craig, I'm the magician. Is there somewhere I can put my fridge, please? Or having a little fridge in the car. I just don't want to do that. What I do want to do is get to the gig, take out the props that I'm going to decide to use at that gig, absolutely kill at that gig and do the best job that I can, and then leave. And that's not, like I say, me being lazy. It's just, I think that I can achieve as much impact without needing a massive amount of preparation than if I did go to the trouble of, you know, making gimmicks that I'd need to keep in a fridge and then, you know, go back and get another gimmick every single time I've done one. I don't want to go down that route. And maybe it's because I do illusion shows. And when I go to an illusion show, man, you know, the amount of stuff that you have to take to an illusion show, how long you have to be there beforehand to set up, it's absolutely crazy. So I love the fact that a close gig, I can rock in, do my thing, and then rock out. I don't do it. And I've had arguments with magicians about this, about, oh, you know, you should do routines like this because they're absolutely amazing. Well, I'm sure they are absolutely amazing, but there's other routines that are absolutely amazing. And that hour that I spent putting gimmicks together, and then that extra time and effort and money I've spent buying a fridge for my car so I can keep the gimmicks cool, you know, that's time that I could have spent with my kids or my family or working on my business or practicing a new routine or something. So no, I don't do it. I do know people that do it and they kill with it. They absolutely kill with it. So, you know, don't let that personal preference put you off buying it. If you want to get it, it's a great trick. It's just one that I'm never going to do. Okay, so the next one is again by Mr. Harmon. Is it worth spending loads of money on getting good at virtual parties, or should I wait till I perform in public? Well, there's two parts to this. The first part to this is you don't know how long again you can perform in public. You don't know how long it's going to be. It could be a week, it could be a month, it could be a year. We don't know. How desperate are you to perform? You know, I know magicians and entertainers and performers that are just completely turned off by the idea of doing virtual magic and doing parties and bookings online. And if that's the case, then fair enough. That's not a problem. That's cool. But you know what? If you're somebody who hates doing virtual magic, well, you know, that answers your question for you. Why would you be spending money on getting good at virtual parties when you hate them? It also is, are you a professional? Are you a semi-professional? How badly do you need the money? You know, because if you don't need the money, you might not want to do virtual parties. You might just want to wait. How desperate are you to perform? My attitude is, I love performing. I wanted to carry on performing, and I didn't want the government to dictate to me when I could or couldn't perform again. So my solution to that was to go and start doing virtual parties. I wanted to be able to do virtual parties as soon as possible. But I'll tell you right now, Mr. Harmon, I didn't spend a penny on it. I haven't bought any specific trick specifically for a virtual or Zoom show. I took what I've got and I adapted it, and I recreated routines, and I created new routines that were designed to work in a Zoom environment, or designed to work online. What I didn't do is buy new tricks, because you don't need to do that. Yeah, there's lots of tricks on the market at the moment that are designed for virtual shows, and some of them are great, but you don't need them. Look at your own repertoire. So you don't need to spend much. Spend loads of money on getting good at virtual parties. You don't need to spend a load of money on getting good at virtual parties. If you're good already, then you can go out and do virtual parties. You just need to, I would argue that you need to spend more time getting good at actually using the platform, because I've seen people do virtual parties and it's been terrible just because they don't know how to use Zoom. They don't understand the difference between spotlighting and not spotlighting, and pinning and not pinning, and when to mute and when to not mute, and why you should have everyone muted, and how to make it, how to make the platform more interactive, and the tricks and tips. That's the thing that you need to practice. That's the thing that you need to get good at, not necessarily the tricks. If you've already got tricks that you're good at, you'll be able to adapt those, and it won't cost you a penny. So realistically, you can get, to sum up, you can do Zoom shows without spending any money at all, or very, very, very limited money that you spend. But ultimately, it's up to you. You know, I don't know your personal circumstances. I don't know how much money you need. I don't know how desperate you are to perform. And nobody knows how long this is going to go on for. So all of these factors kind of come together, and ultimately you're the one that has to make that decision. Okay, so the last question is, who is the best teacher of magic? And that's very subjective. You know, I've always found that Jay Sankey and Richard Sanders are amazing teachers of magic. Sean Farquhar as well. I think Canadians have it in the bag. There you go, Canadians, end off. They are some amazing teachers of magic. But again, it's personal. You know, one of the best lectures I ever saw was David Stone. And it wasn't necessarily because it was the best lecture or he was the best teacher. It was because he was the most entertaining lecture I've ever seen. He was so entertaining. I laughed my ass off. He made a girl appear from underneath his table that had just been sitting there almost the entire lecture. And he's got little things that he does in his lecture just for entertaining magicians. So he does this thing that I've seen him a few times now. One time I saw him, obviously he's French, David Stone. And one of the times I saw him, he had this coin and he was doing this really complicated coin routine, and he dropped it on the floor. And he looked down and he went, "Well, that is a French drop," which he's just brought the house down. It was so funny. Now, it was a scripted moment. He dropped it on purpose because then he did this thing that he snapped his finger and the coin jumped back off the floor and into his hand. And it was all scripted. But it just shows that he'd scripted his lecture. He didn't just turn up to his lecture and go, right, okay, let's do some magic tricks. Let's, you know, kind of wing it. He'd scripted the whole thing to make it entertaining for the magicians that were watching. And I think that's half the battle. I think half the battle is making it entertaining, because if something's entertaining, people are more likely to watch it and get invested in it, right? So David Stone's absolutely brilliant. But, you know, Greg Wilson, for me, is one of the best teachers of magic, because he makes it entertaining. He's an exceptional explainer of magic. He explains things very clearly. He's very clear. His knowledge base is ridiculous. His sleight of hand ability is off the chart, but he's also very, very knowledgeable all aspects of magic and performance and theater and everything else. So I'd say Greg Wilson is right up there as one of the best teachers of magic in the world, in my opinion. So there you go. That's another Q&A session, guys. I hope you enjoyed that. Now, please, 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 if I've missed any questions, I'm very sorry. I tried to go through every video and write them all down. But if I've missed any questions, please drop them down below. And I will promise you that I'll get to them next Sunday. And if you've got any fresh questions, please drop them down below. I love doing these Q&As. I really do, because part of the problem, not the problem, but part of the thing that takes my time is coming up with ideas for content for this channel and trying to make it unique and different and not doing the same thing that everyone else is doing. And doing these Q&As really helps, because it allows me to see what you guys are wanting me to talk about. So, you know, if you enjoy the channel, please ask a question down below. That would be absolutely amazing. And once again, subscribe to the channel. Monday, we've got a Marketing for Magicians. Tuesday, I've got an interview with Lee Smith. Lee Smith is absolutely amazing. He's an unbelievable magician and an exceptional businessman as well. So check out that interview with Lee. I'm back with Ryland on Wednesday. Thursday, we got magic stuff. I've got a really special magic stuff this week. A few weeks ago, I did a video on audience management, and I looked at me doing it in a close-up environment. And so now I'm doing one of those same ones, but I'm looking at coin magic. And specifically, we're looking at some of my videos where I perform coin magic in the real world. And we're breaking that down to show you exactly how to do magic in the real world. So I hope you enjoy that. Look out for that. And yeah, subscribe to the channel, and I'll be back. I'll be back tomorrow with Marketing for Magicians. I'll see you then. Thanks very much for watching.